Good morning. This is Jean-Michel Philippe, and he wants to tell us something about Dudu Linux, which is somehow related to Debian Junior and children, and he will tell you more about this. Thank you.
Hello. Bon. Good. Can you hear me? Yes. Hello. So I'm the founder of a project, Dudu Linux, which is a computer system dedicated for children from 2. Today I'm going to explain why we need such project and how we interact with Debian or try to interact. I'm not going to make any demonstration of Dudu Linux. If you want to see it running, you have to download it and try it with children, preferably. So I'm going to present our project, of course, the system and the project itself. I will also mainly talk about the technology today in our modern society and the need to educate children with free software. Finally, I will talk about Dudu Linux and Debian. Hope you'll be interested. So briefly, how many of you know Dudu Linux? Not so many people. It's going to change, I hope. So this is a computer system especially designed for children from 2 years old. And for this reason, we try to make it as simple as possible. Indeed, our objective is to make it as simple as gaming consoles, because gaming consoles are also computers, and then there is no reason for computers to be so complicated compared to gaming consoles. Dudu Linux is designed by a community of parents whose goals are obviously definitively different from multinational companies. And we are focusing on stimulating children fulfillment. Another objective is to help children really master technology, because we don't want them to undergo technology. We want them to be really the masters. Our project has now 43 language teams on TransFX, our translation portal. And our website has seen more than 350,000 visitors. So it is quite interesting as a project. We also have seen more than 100 contributors, essentially translators, because of numerous language teams. So now let's talk about technology. I'm trying to be as brief as possible, but there is really a lot to say about the technology today. Due to miniaturization, technology is nearly everywhere in our lives. It's already in our pockets, it's going to be in our fridges, in our cars, etc. Of course, there is already a kind of passive technology in fridges, in cars, but this is technology which is performing local actions like temperature regulation. The technology that is that has started to come now is a technology that is really active and will be spying on each of us. This technology will also, and that's probably the main motivation of the manufacturer, will also show ads to us everywhere, at any time, in our kitchens, in our cars, and in our hands. Recently, I heard an interview of a chief officer of a large IT company. I don't remember whether it was Google or Microsoft. And he was speaking about technology in internet in cars, in our cars. And he said that his goal, their goal, was to show ads in real time in our cars from nearby shops as we pass during our trips. So the wonderful future they're preparing us is to have ads everywhere, even in our private areas. Also, you perfectly know what we are doing behind our back. The truth, indeed, is that they're just behaving like malware called Trojan horses. They are offering us stuff that creates desire and admiration, but they forget to tell us what they are going to do behind our back. And if they were telling us what we are really doing, maybe and probably we wouldn't be agreeing. And I think you surely know. The main objective of what I call Trojan horse technology is to control our minds indirectly. Of course, flooding us with real-time ads is a way to influence our minds because they know what are our current topics of interest. And of course, advertisement has shown to be working well. So targeted advertisement will work even better. Offering a centralized search engine is also another way to influence our minds because these search engines intervene between the world and us. People often believe that search engines are objective, but this is not true. Some months ago, I heard the CEO of Microsoft France on a radio station, and he was speaking about Bing. He explained without any scruple that Bing is favoring in its results companies that have a commercial contract with Microsoft. Of course, he said this is best for users, and he even said that this is what users want. The truth is that finally, search engines have turned into a kind of advertisement display. They should not be considered as objective anymore. You also know that Google is building filtering bubbles around each of us, still for our best interest, supposedly. The fact that searches depend on who asks for the query shows that they have a hidden intention. They want to change, to influence on our mind. So in the end, as technology interferes with most, almost everything in our modern society, technology is becoming the great toll booth of the world, of the entire world, a kind of a mandatory checkpoint. Just as mass market retailing has put itself between producers and us, technology is putting itself between the world and us. And you all know how difficult it is for producers to negotiate with mass market retailing. This is going to happen at a global scale with IT, with information technology. Because IT is mainly in the hands of few actors, few private companies, more precisely. I believe that if information was in the hands of people, of the whole population through democratic and organization and processes, there would be no major objection in having all our society depending on information technology. But sadly, this is not the case at all. Information today is under the control of a minority who serve their sole self-interest. So, for example, earning more money, breaking competitors, ignoring working conditions of their subcontractors, imposing their will on everyone. Of course, they say and they wish us to believe that this is for our best interest, as usual. And sadly, many people believe this. So, if we let them do, our future is going to offer us less choice, less freedom, and less opportunity. So, while technology can improve our lives, it can also reduce freedom, our freedom. Instead of being the robots of human beings, technology can turn us into its own robots. If you've ever read science fiction books from the 30s or the 40s, for example, 1984 from George Orwell, Fahrenheit 451 from Ray Bradbury, or Brave New World from Aldous Huxley, nearly half of these books have already been realized. For example, Big Brother is almost in our pockets. Aggressive advertising, it's existing too. Walls of TV sets, they are existing. Violence and sex on TV, that's not new. And loss of literacy culture, this is happening too. Indeed, Google perfectly chose its logo for Android. Really, the robot, indeed, is not their software, but it's you. In 2011, I read the speech of a former CEO of Google for the announcement of the creation of a research center in Germany. And part of his speech was about the future Google is imagining for us. And he said he wants us to spend all our time on smartphones playing games, stupid games, of course. And as our smartphones are smart, on the contrary, these devices would tell us what we have to do. For example, go to this bakery to buy some bread, have dinner in this restaurant because the fridge is empty, walk this street to meet this friend and not another friend that is in another street, prefer this book, watch this film, and so, and why not vote for Mr. So-and-so? I think this will happen in the near future. He didn't say this, naturally. So, program or be programmed is really our future, and maybe it's already our present. Of course, we don't want that for our children. Maybe some people would like this future to happen, but I don't, and I believe that you don't either. The major issue we are facing, and this is the main purpose of this lightning talk, is that our children will build the future we'll be living in within 10, 20 years or more. So, children are obviously our future, and if they are fond of Android, we will be surrounded with green robots treating us as their own robots. If they are mad of high stuff, we will be eating apples all day long with their worms. So, if they like too much to just press OK or like, instead of thinking, comparing, analyzing, making by themselves, then once adults, they will build our future with Trojan horse technology only. And we, their parents, we won't have no more choice because we will have missed the boat right now. Just look. 80 years ago, novel authors started to write and to warn about a possible drift in technology use. And where are we today? Half of these stories have been already achieved. So it's no use warning if nobody reacts. And I believe you can react. So now let's look at technology for small children. Now that many in the audience have some fear about our emerging future. There are gaming consoles that are said to be for children from 3. There are now Android and iOS tablets that are also said to be for children from 3. There are TV channels claiming that they show TV program for children from 1 or 2 years old, educative programs. The important point is the underlying objectives of these technologies. Is it to stimulate our children's fulfillment, about which we as parents are especially careful? The answer is, you've guessed it, no. 1 year ago, still on a national radio channel, I heard a report about game companies hiring neuropsychiatrist specialists. You could think their role was to help video games to be good for people, or at least not too bad. But indeed, I was very surprised, but this was not at all the objective. The objective was to make games as addictive as possible. They were not trying to make us smarter. They were not trying to make us improve our skills. They just want us to be locked in a system they are fully controlling. They want us to be dominated by the machine. Another important issue with this technology is profusion of entertainment. You just switch on and you get a flow of videos, animation, games, anything. It is running itself. No need to act. So you can put your children in front of TV, go shopping for hours, and when you're back at home, your children are still in front of TV, and you can repeat this experiment with gaming consoles, internet, YouTube, anything. This works the same. Reading requires efforts, making requires efforts, and children prefer be lazy if we don't do anything. There are studies in the USA showing that children who daily spend more time on TV, up to 3 hours per day, are also the children who get the worst results at school. So just pushing the button on is the easiest, but probably not the most self-fulfilling. So, because of technology, you can see that children are losing skills. There are other studies in France showing that children now have less vocabulary than the former generation, us. Similarly, we, the parents, have less vocabulary than our own parents. In 1984, you know, there is impoverishment of vocabulary. The objective is to better enslave people, to prevent them from thinking. And sadly, this is going to happen now. The permanent flow of digital stuff is diverting children from doing and thinking by themselves. There is at least one book called A Popular History of Science that tries to show that the population is losing skills and know-how. And this book says that it started with industrialization. So if we cannot do anything by ourselves, the only solution is to buy. And to buy what Google, Microsoft, Apple, and so is telling us to buy. So, hope you're not too pessimistic about our future. Now, let's look at what the largest companies do to make us love their products. I'm not a marketing expert at all, but I believe that what I'm going to tell is just a basic marketing strategy. and it's just called brainwashing. One of the champions is McDonald's, who targets very small children, nearly from their birth, with their ads showing very small, you can say, even babies. And the surprise that is included in their meal for the smallest children. They've understood that education is starting as soon as children are born. similarly, about 10 years ago, Nutella started a TV campaign to recall young adults the good days of childhood, with Nutella, of course. So converting people to a product during their childhood is a good way, and probably the best way, to get their affection for life. I believe that digital devices and services are doing the same. And this is why we can see now devices for children from 2 or 3 years old. The question is why should free software not do the same? Why free software should only target very technical people that have the curiosity to understand the reason of free software. I believe that we have to offer software and devices for children from 2, and we have to manage to make Linux recall the good memories of childhood. It should not sound like something complicated or difficult, but like something nice and wonderful. The only issue is to find a way to achieve brainwashing with free software, because we don't have the money McDonald's has, of course. So how to succeed? I don't pretend to know how to succeed, of course, but this is just my thoughts and suggestion, and you can consider that this is our guidelines for Dodo Linux. So, unfortunately for us, usually people are not interested in the 4 liberties of free software. They just want something that looks great. This is the wow effect. They also want something that is not a pain, something that easy to master. They don't want something that would put them in a situation in which they cannot answer their children. So Linux has to look like a treasure chest to create desire from users, and especially children in our case. Like our competitors, TV, gaming consoles, and tablets, we need to be attractive and nice and fun. If it's boring, no child will be interested in using Linux. We also need something that is easy to use, safe, secure, and robust. No headaches. Parents should not wonder if they will be able to master the device. And unlike our competitors, we can also focus on stimulating self-fulfillment. Probably we can also provide stuff that are saner than our competitors, because we don't have hidden goals dictated by secret commercial contracts or private interests. But if we don't make these differences obvious, if people can't make the difference between free software and, standard technology, they won't be more interested in our offer. So we have to make this obvious, to write clearly down the differences. So, now let's talk about Dodo Linux at last. So after 3 years of existence, we've now achieved a good work, good results that many people appreciate. The interface indeed is rebuilt, has been rebuilt from ground up to remove everything that is not strictly necessary. So in the interface of Doodle Linux, you won't find a right-click menu to get some additional functionalities. On the desktop, you don't have files that you can move or remove, add, rename, and so. This is finally like a tablet interface. You just have the application icons, and they cannot be moved. We are lucky enough to have two professional artists and graphic designers. So we have a quite nice interface. One of our artists is himself a comic artist. We have selected about 75 applications that are educative, creative, and entertaining. Most of them come from the official Debian repositories. And we have some additions, but not so many. We have started to open children to culture, thanks to digital contents. We want to show children culture from everywhere in the world, so that they like culture and like culture from other countries. We are also promoting a web project that have a philosophy similar to our project. So, for example, Wikipedia, Open Clip Art Library. We are doing this thanks to the homepage of the web browser. The web browser, instead of showing the Google search page, is showing icons of a website we have selected. And finally, it is also easy for parents because obviously, as we want it to be easy for children, parents don't have so many difficulties to use it too. And we believe that this is one of the reasons of our success. The future of our project. So, despite the fact that we have already achieved a good work, indeed, we are still a young project and we have a lot of ideas to develop Doodle Linux. What we would like to do is to show all the possible uses of computers. Unlike computers that you can buy in a supermarket, we want children to be able to do everything that can be done with a computer, not only office suits and internet. So on this slide, you have the most important topics for us, but we have also other ideas that you can find on our website. And unfortunately, we are very far from having achieved all the work. So now let's talk about Doodle Linux and Debian. One of our concerns was to keep the project away from any self-interested influence. So we wanted Doodle Linux to be based on a community project. And for this reason, Debian is certainly one of the best choice. Of the other reasons why we chose Debian is the stability of the distribution, the large number of softwares in the official repositories, and the variety of hardware platforms. Currently, Doodle Linux is built for Intel-like processors, and we have a kind of demonstration system for ARM. We don't have a version for PowerPC because we cannot build for PowerPC, but if we could, we would do. What we want to do is to be as close to Debian as possible, because we want to spend as few time as possible on developing the system. So instead of redeveloping our own distribution, we are trying to use Debian as most as possible. And this way we can spend more time on providing what Debian is not providing for the smallest children. Currently, this is based on Debian Live, and I think that this will stay based. This will be based on Debian Live for a long time again. Yes, and two years ago, we joined the derivatives initiative. And we were also proposed to revive Debian Junior, but we have just started to do this this year. So what can we bring to Debian? Of course, we would like to bring as many things as we can. So the first thing is to move our package lists into Debian Junior. This needs us to think the package lists in order to make them match. Indeed, both projects, how can I say this, designed their package lists in a very different manner. So it's a bit complicated right now to move our package list directly into Debian Junior. We also have encountered packages that are not really maintained anymore in the Debian official archive. For example, Songwrite. And we were proposed to take over for the maintenance of the package. We would like to do this, but we don't have time right now to dive into the process of maintaining a package in the Debian archive. We also have a dedicated package repository in which we have our own packages to customize the environment, but we also have patch packages from the Debian archive. We also have newer software than the Debian archive, and we have additional software that is not in Debian. So we could move part of our repository into the official Debian archive, but again, this requires some help from Debian developers. What can I tell more? Yes, of course, finally, if you want us to present our project in Debian events, no problem, we can come if we are available. And what I would like to add is that for Debian, our long-haul objective is to bring Debian more users, more fans, more developers, and more supporters, because we would have succeeded in making Debian more used by children in the world from 2 or even earlier. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have some questions, I can try to answer.
I have the first question myself, because I was also in this Debian Junior project. And I would really like to get it revitalized. And from my experience, if you are running such projects, you can attract Debian developers. We have in the Debian Made project, we have 10 developers who confirmed they are only Debian developers because the project exists. So if you try to run this project, Debian Junior, how it is called, it doesn't matter. We can really attract people. And if I see all the children here, the parents are the potential Debian developers if they are not yet. I think we should start with migrating your packages to start to Debian. I don't know if you know this because I have this this kind of effort that is called sponsoring of blends. So if you don't find a sponsor and your package is on the list of the target packages, just talk to me, because there is currently no existing packaging team for Debian Junior. And I really hope we can change this. Okay, anybody else? Questions? Okay.
I'm unsure. You mentioned that you have a homepage where you list other similar projects.
Yes.
I'm unsure. Did you hear about the Yux project? It's a live CD which was done in Vienna, my hometown. That's why I know about it. And they also do it specifically for kids. They have also one for very small children. And usually they started out from for teenagers, but in the later years they also switched to smaller children. Do you have do you use the Gcompre software on
what
Dodo
software?
Linux?
Gcompre. Ah, Gcompre, yes. Yes, yes, of course, yes.
Okay.
Gcompre is one of the most interesting software in the Linux.
So if you haven't heard about the Yux project yet, I will get you in contact afterwards.
You know if they would be interested in the Linux?
I assume so, yes.
Yes?
Andrea Meyer, who runs the project, is always interested in exchanging ideas and things with other people doing work in the same area.
One of our issue is to find people in every country that gets involved enough to provide resources that match the children of the country. I can do this for French children, but for German or Austrian children, this is more complicated.
So yes, here we are.
Right.
Could you maybe show how Dodo Linux looks like for us here?
Yes, I think I can. This is the French one. So it requires tens of seconds to start. So this is the live Debian live standard boot up process. The text here is supposed to be changed with the language of the CD. What I didn't tell is that on our website you can download directly the DVD in your own language. So as we have now more than 40 language teams, you can find on our website more than 40 DVDs. The objective is to avoid children and parents to have something to do when the computer starts, to get the system in their own language. So this is the main menu. The idea is to offer a menu in the order of difficulty. The first activity is very, very simple. I can show you. I hope it won't crash in a virtual box. This is a very simple software to teach children the use of a mouse. So I have no mouse, but usually when you propose a very small child to use the computer, he takes the mouse and does this. And he doesn't understand that the mouse is moving the cursor on the screen. So this application just shows that when you are moving the mouse, this is moving something on the screen and it draws a line. If you click on the buttons, this is doing something. I have no sound. Maybe I can plug the sound? So there is a sound when you click on the mouse buttons. Similarly, if children press the keys, you have the letter of the key that is drawn on screen. And this shows children that can't read that the sign that is on the key is also drawn on the screen. Usually, children get bored with this application after 1 or 2 weeks of use because they have understood that it's not so complicated. So you can drive them to the second application that is still around the mouse. And the objective is to teach children double clicks, right clicks, click and move.
Attrape tous les éléments.
Usually I show this activity. No, not this one. Non, c'est celle-là.
Amène chaque animal à son refuge. Amène.
This one. You have to move the animals in their home. And if you right click, it goes right. And if you left click, it goes left. Voilà.
Click if click sur.
So after in the menu you have TuxPaint, which is a well-known application to draw. You have Child's Play, which is a small suite of educative activities. a reduced version of J'ai compris with only the easiest activities of J'ai compris, because J'ai compris is really large. And then, in the end, you have two activities that are more looking like a computer, a small version in which you just find mainly the previous activities plus additional activities. And you have two tabs, one for tuning and another one for the activities. Usually, children don't spend so much time on these activities. Usually, once they can use the mouse and the keyboard, they want to do like the big children do, or like adults do. And then, qu'est-ce que j'ai fait moi?
Ah,
I stopped. And usually they want to enter the most advanced activities in this activity you have four categories of applications. So you'll find education, what else, working, playing, entertaining, and multimedia. We have to let it start again. What?
Yeah, during the, I want to ask a question. I saw that, well, during this DevConf and in the, well, in some other gatherings, we have already had some meetings about, unofficial meetings about how to revive the Debian Union and stuff. And it seems that like a lot of the Debian contributors and Debian and people close to Debian are interested in that, and we're not being able to coordinate ourselves or finding someone to lead the project. What are your plans about that? We work together. I mean, here we have already had two unofficial gatherings talking about how to revive
yes.
Debian Union. So we might kind of like to work together.
Yes, I must say I don't plan anything right now. Yes, probably what would be best working is to meet us later physically or on the internet and discuss about how to make things go on.
Yeah, but what I mean is that at some point we will have to, I don't know, decide and someone. Or there should be someone doing something for starters, leading the project, creating some stuff. Are you planning to do that, to lead the revival of the of Linux Junior, or just I mean, just for coordination? Maybe we can.
Why
talk
not?
Later.
Yes, I can. If there is nobody who advantage is that I know Dodo Linux, so probably it's. Easier for me to know what can be moved from Dodo Linux to Debian Junior easily. But I must say I have no precise idea of what we should do in Debian Junior right now.
What she's trying to do is that there are volunteers, but nobody yet who's willing to coordinate and lead the group. And she's asking you if you could do that. I guess you lack a bit of Debian experience, so maybe you would need someone, someone else on the Debian side to explain you. But if you have the motivation and a bit of time, it would be great to play the leader role. I mean, we have a good example in the room of someone who is leading, who doesn't need to be very technical savvy, and
yes,
and he can do a lot of great work. So
you're right. Yes, we have nobody in our team who has experience with Debian maintaining packages. So.
Well, you're building packages. Maybe they are not yet clean as they should, but I mean,
yes.
if you have done, I think you have the skills already, so it shouldn't be too difficult to get within Debian as Debian maintainer or as Debian developer even. Don't be afraid. You're not really so so hard
but
on,
well,
on beginners.
If there are volunteers to help us package for Debian. This will be much easier for us because obviously we can help extracting our packages and we need people to dive into them and correct what needs to be corrected.
Maybe we can meet later, or the people who's interested.
I don't know if it needs a lot of time to decide how to coordinate. Maybe we can do this just after.
Yes. I think we should meet like right after when this session is finished, just to talk about, because I'm really interested in the Debian Junior project also in games, and how that can be used both as propaganda for Debian and to get new developers in, and also to for children, of course. So if nobody's taking on that hat of leading the Debian junior team, I can take it on now, officially on video. Okay. But let's meet afterwards and we can... but what I wonder about Dudu Linux is, we have a kid now that's 2 years old, that's here, obviously. And we had these sessions on a conference in Sweden, a free software conference, where we just started. When we had kids, we went there with our two-month-old kid and realized that, oh, shit, this is not prepared for kids or families with kids at all. So next year, we made a session ourselves, just a two-hour workshop with This Is For Kids, and we had Dudu Linux, you had Q something something Linux, and Arduinos, and stuff like this, and it was super popular. So that made people come there that wouldn't have attended conference otherwise, with their kids, and then later on also.
Okay.
So this year, this fall actually, we will have an entire track during this conference. I just wanted to share a success story. But I wonder one thing about Dudu Linux also is that can you actually, can you go to the real operating system from this, or are you locked in with this sort of dumbed down interface?
Yes. So.
I'm sorry. We should continue right afterwards, but time is over. The video needs to be cut. And thank you very much, Jean-Michel. And I hope we get some people together to find some ways how to cooperate. Okay, thank you.
That's right. Thank you.